polycystic ovarian syndrome, its recent advances and state of the art. Basically, let's begin with this case, a 14-year-old girl with hirsutism. Her menarche was a year back with cycles every 2 months and has a mild hirsutism with a Ferrigman-Galloway score of 6. Somebody did an ultrasound which had a polycystic ovarian appearance, and a diagnosis of polycystic ovaries was made. Now, this is because happened within the first year of menarche, could be a case of physiological hyperandrogenism. Another girl, 14-year-old, with hirsutism, menarche 1 year, cycles every 2 months, but this girl has significant hirsutism with a Ferrigman-Galloway score of 18, virilization, and even muscular changes like masculine muscular changes. Her ultrasound also showed polycystic ovarian appearance, and a diagnosis of PCOS was made, and she unfortunately turned out to be adrenal carcinoma. So polycystic ovarian syndrome, especially in adolescent, are both, you know, overdiagnosed and even missed. So it has to be, you know, carefully evaluated. Especially hyperandrogenism is quite common in puberty and pubertal girls. But pathological hyperandrogenism most commonly is due to polycystic ovarian syndrome. But also about 5% cases could be non-classical CAH or rarely tumors and even idiopathic. So it's very important to carefully identify cases to rule out PCOS, which is a diagnosis of exclusion. So in the next few slides, we'll be knowing what exactly is polycystic ovarian syndrome in the perspective of adolescent girls. We'll also try to know why it happens and how should we manage it. So three classical triads of PCOS are hyperandrogenism, anovulation, and polycystic ovarian morphology on ultrasound. Now, hyperandrogenism could be clinical hyperandrogenism or biochemical hyperandrogenism. Clinical hyperandrogenism is hirsutism or recalcitrant acne, alopecia. Anovulation generally presents with irregular periods. Now, basically, when this triad happens, it's very important to rule out all causes of hyperandrogenism and anovulation before we can label it PCOS. And this has to be persistent for a chronic period of time. So at least 1 to 2 years before we can say this is PCOS, and has to be of intra-ovarian origin. Now, PCOS, and especially in adult perspective, has been subclassified into 4 categories. PCOS type 1 has all the 3 triads. PCOS type 2 is hyperandrogenic anovulatory girls without the polycystic ovarian morphology. Type 3 are the classical cases of ovulatory hyperandrogenism, and type 4 are the cases where there is no hyperandrogenism, probably intra-ovarian hyperandrogenism with only polycystic ovarian morphology and anovulation. The classical PCOS takes into account the PCOS-1, the NIH criteria PCOS-1 and 2, the Androgen Society criteria basically takes care of the 3, and the Rotterdam is the most lenient one classification, which takes into account all 4 categories. But when we look into it's basically from the point of view of androgen, the PCOS type 4 is in the very left end of the spectrum where the minimal androgens are there, and same as with the insulin resistance. As we go higher up the ladder, the more insulin resistance we will encounter in PCOS type 1. For adolescent PCOS, the most important thing would be a diagnostic challenge, because in adolescent age group, we already have an hyperandrogenic state due to the immature hypothalamic pituitary axis. About 12% girls have some form of clinical hyperandrogenism like mild hirsutism or acne. Physiological anovulation is also very common. About 50% of girls in the first 2 years of menarche have irregular periods and have anovulatory cycles. Now, the criteria and the cutoffs for testosterone and androgen levels are not very clearly defined for adolescent girls. And last but not the least, many girls, due to having a higher ovarian reserves, can have an ultrasound presentation of polycystic ovarian pattern. As many as 1/3 of girls can have that. So the it's very challenging to diagnose adolescent PCOS. So North American Society of Pediatric and Adolescent Gynecology have done away with the polycystic ovarian morphology as a criteria for diagnosis of PCOS in adolescent girls. It's very important that all girls should have both hyperandrogenism and anovulation before we can label them as PCOS. For hyperandrogenism, the criteria taken into account is biochemical, high levels of testosterone, but also because of the fallacies of the tests available, moderate to severe hirsutism or severe recalcitrant acne could be a clinical measure of hyperandrogenism. For anovulation, definitely age-specific criteria. So an anovulatory girl presents generally with irregular periods, and we have to take into account what is irregular depending on the age of menarche. And it has to be a chronic condition when we have ruled out all other causes of hyperandrogenism. Just a quick word on modified Ferriman-Galloway score, where we score the presence of hairs in the the sexual areas of the body and grade them according to the severity. Mild cases, if the score is less than 8, it is normal. Mild is 8 to 15. And above 15, we would regard as moderate to severe hirsutism. The problem with hirsutism is that it is basically different in various races. So even in India, if you look at, you will have a higher score of hirsutism in people from Punjabi origin, and a lower score of hirsutism from northeastern and the eastern side of the country. The South Indian women generally present more with acne rather than hirsutism as a marker of cutaneous manifestation of hyperandrogenism. So there is a very imperfect correlation with the actual androgen levels, but as a screening measures, when to test for hyperandrogenism, I would say because if we take a score of 15, only about 16% of girls turn out to be idiopathic hirsutism. Therefore, a score of 15 should be regarded as when we should look at, think about hyperandrogenism not being physiological. Now, coming on to androgen assessment, the first thing that we need to know that androgen being a steroid hormone in the blood, it travels. So only about 1% of the testosterone is free. Now, this is the free testosterone that is physiologically active. And we are more concerned with the free testosterone, not the total testosterone. Estrogen and thyroid hormones actually increase the serum hormone binding globulin, and testosterone and insulin increase the SSBG, and therefore the fraction of free testosterone basically increases and decreases according to the presence of other hormones. Basically, what should we measure? Should we measure total testosterone or free testosterone? In fact, total testosterone is a good screening measure because it's easy to test and you can test it anytime. But in specific cases, if you test it 8 a.m. in the morning in the first 4 to 10 days of your period, then it is a better way because then you can, take care of the effect of the growing estrogen in the mid part of the cycle that would decrease the SHBG. The best assay is the GCMS, but it's not available in many labs. And the immunoassay method is to be taken with caution. The levels in the last 10 years have changed. In the past, we would say 80 nanograms per deciliter as a cutoff value, but it has decreased from 60 to 55. And the latest NASPAC guidelines are recommending a 48 nanograms per deciliter. So if you look at adolescent girls, usually majority of girls fall with a testosterone level of somewhere between 10 to 20 nanograms per deciliter. And 46 is the upper limit of normal value. Basically, estrogen and progesterone taken in the last 2 months could interfere with the SHBG levels, and therefore caution should be taken before testing that the patient was not on pills in the past 2 months or not on steroids. Free testosterone is a more highly sensitive test, but when it is done through equilibrium dialysis method, most of the labs are doing SHBG back calculation, but that is not a very specific way of identifying. But definitely the role of free testosterone would be if you have a clinically hyperandrogenic girl and the total testosterone comes out to be normal. In those cases, because this is a beta sensitive test, you could do a free testosterone to differentiate between a true hyperandrogenism from idiopathic hirsutism. So the total testosterone value, if it is less than 95, we regard as normal, and 55 we regard as normal. Between 55 to 150 is the PCOS range, but anything above 150 is the virile male levels, and those should be investigated for, you know, adrenal tumors. Now, coming on to anovulation. So this is the second aspect of polycystic ovarian syndrome, which is chronic anovulation. And anovulation basically presents in a few ways. It can present as amenorrhea. It could be primary. If the girl has early onset PCOS, she could never have period, or, you know, would have a disjuncted puberty, not start period even 3 years after menarche, or develop secondary amenorrhea, which means that she cycles every 90 days. Oligomenorrhea, or scanty periods or less frequent periods, should be judged on the basis of the number of years of menarche. So in the first post-menarchal year, if the girl is having less than 4 periods, she's oligomenorrheic. In the second year, if she cycles every 2 months, she is oligomenorrheic. And in the next 2 to 5 years, if the cycles are longer than 6 weeks, so she's having less than 8 periods, she's oligomenorrheic. And after 5 years, you have to take the adult criteria of oligomenorrhea, which is 35 days of cycle. It's very important because commonly gynecologists use adult criteria for identifying anovulation in younger women. So if any young girl is having periods, say more than 35 days, doesn't mean she has anovulation or a chronic anovulatory condition. Menorrhagia is also another presentation of anovulatory cycles. But to identify menorrhagia, we need to rule out any gynecological causes of menorrhagia, like fibroids or cysts, and before we say that this is only because of anovulation. And also, I rule out, you know, any bleeding diathesis. Menorrhagia is somebody's bleeding more than 7 days or bleeding very frequently. And this is one of the criteria of anovulation. So basically, chronic anovulation is one of the features of polycystic ovarian syndrome and only take into criteria if persistent for 1 to 2 years. So polycystic ovarian syndrome, why does the ovaries in the first place start to produce more hyperandrogenism, you know, more androgens? So androgen, 50% of androgen in women come from ovaries, and they are mostly under the influence of LH production is androstenedione. And in the adrenals, it is under ACTH, DHEAS, testosterone, and androstenedione. Androstenedione and DHEAS ultimately in the peripheral fat tissue, adipose tissue, get converted under the influence of 17-beta-hydroxysteroid dehydrogenase into testosterone. So basically, the androgen tone is higher in PCOS. And why does that increase? Most cases of PCOS, up to 70%, it is the ovaries that are the culprit, and we call it functional ovarian hyperandrogenism, that lead to higher production of androgens. But about 5%, it is the functional adrenal hyperandrogenism. About 20%, what we call as atypical PCOS, both polycystic ovarian syndrome is due to both FOH and FAH. And 5% of cases, and that is very important, could be just the peripheral production of testosterone. Racially, we see that very mild adiposity can lead to hyperandrogenic state in races, the Asian races, especially Indian, but Caucasian races, a very high level of adiposity is required for the development of polycystic ovarian disease. That shows the genetic predisposition of ovaries to FOH and the adrenals to FAH in these races. So what leads to functional ovarian hyperandrogenism? The ovaries are said to produce more androgens in a two-hit hypothesis. The first hit is, of course, intrauterine, when the ovaries are being created. And this could be acquired, especially due to fetal nutrition conditions, when the mother has a metabolic syndrome of pregnancy, the gestational diabetes, where you have SGA babies. The ovaries, you know, have a high set tone for LH, and they produce more androgens. But it could be genetic also. In about you see a 70% heritability in PCOS families, and that is more of paternal effect. In genome-wide study, we found one gene, DNDA1A, V2 variant. The protein of this gene actually produces a cell surface protein that increases the sensitivity of theca cells to LH. And that leads to higher androgen production at the same level of LH. And that is why a subgroup of patients could be genetic PCOS. The second hit, so we have this ovaries that have a tendency to PCOS, but they would not become PCOS until they are second hit by, and this is more important in the cases of SGA babies, if they develop obesity or insulin resistance, especially during puberty. So when such ovaries that are, you know, prone to a high set for LH, are prone to PCOS, develop obesity or lifestyle disorders in adolescent age group, they develop an intrinsic defect and produce more androgens than a normal ovary. So how does this happen? We all know that LH activates the 17 hydroxylase and 21 hydroxylase to convert the progesterone into androstenedione, which under the effect of FSH in the granulosa cell, basically converts into estradiol due to aromatase. Now, LH can be in the intrinsic defect. The theca cells can be highly sensitive to LH, or they can be insulin resistance leading to high insulin levels and IGF-1 levels, which can lead to ovary leading producing more androgens. Another effect is the overspill hypothesis, excess adiposity. When it fills up the adipose stores of the periphery, overspills into the liver and the muscles and leads to insulin resistance. Now, insulin resistance, both in the liver and muscles, is basically escaped from the ovaries. So this probably happens because it might be an adaptation for undernutrition to prevent, fertility issues. So ovary is a more required organ in that sense, for the generation to grow, and that's why insulin resistance does not happen within the ovary, and elevated insulin levels in insulin resistance actually become counterproductive, and this insulin goes to the ovaries and increases the tone of androgen production from the ovaries. Insulin, in fact, has a multi-pronged attack. So it acts at many levels of androgen production and increases the androgens. So insulin resistance can lead to decreased IGF binding protein, relatively high IGF-1. It also decreases the SHBG, relatively high free testosterone. Insulin has a direct effect, as we really saw, on the theca cells to increase the LH tone and LH effect. It has a direct effect on the adrenals to produce DHEAS, direct effect to increase the LH tone on the pituitary, and direct effect in the adipose tissue to increase the drive of 17 beta hydroxy and conversion of androstenedione to testosterone. Androgens, in fact, have a positive feedback to insulin resistance. So androgen act on the adipocyte leads to production of adiponectin. So this is sort of a vicious cycle in which insulin is increasing the androgens and androgen is increasing the insulin resistance. And that's why it's very important to break this chain when we are treating patients of PCOS, because this is sort of a chain reaction that happens with insulin resistance. Now, androgen transport, we've already seen that SHBG levels. So androgen is also basically amplifying its effect, because testosterone decreases the SHBG levels and increase the free testosterone level, which is the active hormone that causes the cutaneous manifestations of hyperandrogenism. Ovarian effect. So intra-ovarian hyperandrogenism basically leads to two very major effects. One would be to recruit more and more androgen follicles or smaller follicles that produce more testosterone. And at this another level, it prevents the maturation of these androgen follicles, which two dominant follicles, which produce more estrogen. So intra-ovarian androgen leads to the polycystic ovarian morphology and higher production of androgens from the ovaries. So sort of another amplifying effect, the third amplifying effect of the androgens in production of androgens. And it is also very important here to note that any cause of hyperandrogenism would lead to the presentation of polycystic ovarian morphology, because the androgen effect is in such a way that it will recruit more smaller follicle and prevent the development of dominant follicle. So just because there is a polycystic ovarian morphology, we cannot make a diagnosis of polycystic ovaries. The last but not the least, the androgens, basically, we all know that LH is inhibited by progesterone and FSH is inhibited by estrogen in the feedback, negative feedback mechanism. But androgen inhibits the inhibitory effect of progesterone. And that is why the intrauterine exposure of androgens, basically in utero, would lead to a higher LH tone of hypothalamic pituitary axis and lead to ovarian hyperandrogenism, especially in girls with CAH or in mothers with aromatase deficiency. Basically, you will have women with high LH and functional ovarian hyperandrogenism. So coming on to assessment of PCOS, and we all know clinically hyperandrogenism and chronic anovulation, biochemically the testosterone levels or even free testosterone. The most important thing would be to rule out other causes of hyperandrogenism. Coming on to polycystic ovarian morphology. Polycystic ovarian morphology, as the ultrasound machines are becoming better and better, we are picking up more of polycystic ovarian morphologies in more and more young teenagers, and the criteria are changing. So in adults, now we require that if the volume is more than 10 ml and the number of follicles peripherally arranged are more than 10, we call this as a polycystic ovarian morphology. What is a multicystic ovaries? Multicystic ovaries, on the other hand, the volume is normal. It's just that the number of follicles are more, but this is normal. Now, the problem with adolescent is that we are unable to do a transvaginal scan, which gives a better picture to the ovaries. And plus, there are more and more girls with multicystic ovaries due to the higher ovarian reserve in them. As much as 30% of girls can have a multicystic or a polycystic appearance. And therefore, now the cutoff values is not the number of follicles, it's the volume. So that we, rule out the multicystic ovaries and pick up only the polycystic ovaries. And for the definition of polycystic ovarian syndrome, we have completely done away with the polycystic ovarian morphology. It is only for the at-risk individual, which can, as adult, become polycystic ovarian syndrome. But for the diagnosis of PCOS in adolescent, it is not a criteria, neither you can exclude it by not having PCOS, PCOM. So pointers for other factors could be in CAH, hyperpigmentation, hypertension in left hydroxylase and Cushing syndrome, and virilization in adrenal tumors. So basically, we need to rule out other causes of hyperandrogenism and anovulation before we can, label this girl as polycystic ovarian syndrome. And definitely, any cause of anovulation and any cause of hyperandrogenism, maybe chronic disease, celiac disease, premature ovarian insufficiency, hyperprolactinemia, hypothyroidism can lead to both anovulation and in initial stages due to anovulation, hyperandrogenism. So all these causes should be ruled out. And if needed, causes like Cushing syndrome and non-classical CAH should also be ruled out before we label a young woman as PCOS. So coming on to cortisol levels, you all know about this. A cutoff of more than 276, a workup for Cushing syndrome should be done. For 17 OHP, we generally recommend if somebody has a pre-pubertal onset or, pre-menarchal onset of hirsutism, or there is a family history, do a 17 OHP test. Very importantly, because of the confounding factors of estrogen, increasing the SHBG levels, they should be done in the first 2 to 10 days of period. And an ACTH stimulation test could be done for unequivocal results. Prolactin, we all know, significant prolactin level would be 2 reports more than 25 nanograms when we have ruled out any drugs that could lead to hyperprolactinemia. and then work up for microadenomas and doing an MRI should be done. DHEAS is a must-do test and should be done in all cases where you want to rule out hyperandrogenism as a cause of functional adrenal hyperplasia, hyperandrogenism. A value less than rules out any adrenal hyperactivity, and a value more than 700, you should rule out any adrenal tumors. So basically, in the past, for diagnosis of PCOS, we used to use insulin to, you know, pick up insulin resistance, but we have completely, you know, the latest guidelines have completely done away with doing insulin resistance testing. The presence of obesity and metabolic syndrome, and are the surrogate markers of metabolic syndrome, are the markers of insulin resistance. And because at tissue level, because they are a better marker of tissue level insulin resistance. So presence of features of metabolic syndrome, one should think that PCOS associated with insulin resistance is already there. So how do we approach? So if there is a girl with hyperandrogenism and anovulation, look for clinical features. And if there are significant clinical features like FGS more than 15, refractory acne or alopecia, if they are not present, then this is could be a physiological hyperandrogenism. You should just follow up this girl to see how she goes. But if they are present, then look for any virilization features. If virilization features are present, like clitoromegaly or voice changes, or testosterone level is really high, more than 150, then, you know, an ovarian or adrenal imaging should be done to rule out adrenal ovarian tumors that are producing this virile levels of testosterone. If they are not present, then screening tests should be done. And screening tests should be, you know, you should look at the hypothalamic pituitary axis to rule out premature ovarian insufficiency, do cortisol, prolactin, 17-OHP, thyroid, you know. And if DHEAS is very high, again, adrenal imaging should be done. And if the 17-OHP is high, it could be a non-classical case. And all these things are ruled out, then this is polycystic ovarian syndrome. How to manage? The goals of management of polycystic ovarian syndrome is to correct the hyperandrogenism, the cutaneous manifestations, the hirsutism, to make the periods better, especially menorrhagia, because that could lead to anemia. And a long term, so we should not look at PCOS only as a high testosterone state. It is also high estrogen state with unopposed progesterone, because chronic anovulation, progesterone levels are less. So this predisposes these young girls to endometrial cancer in adulthood. That's why it's very important for them to have regular cycles. So besides correcting menorrhagia, it's important to give them at least 8 to 10 cycles in a year. And last but not the least, to correct the metabolic parameters. Now the second hit hypothesis of PCOS nowadays says that all cases of adolescent PCOS should be revisited in adulthood, because some of them could be immature hypothalamic pituitary axis presenting as PCOS temporarily. But because of a chronic hyperandrogenic state, their gonadus hypothalamic pituitary axis would set at a high LH level. So this, to prevent the second hit, we could actually prevent development of the type 1 PCOS in a type 4 PCOS girl by giving them long-term regular hormones. So these are the goals. And how do we give them? We give them estrogen and progesterone combination. And these are present in the market in the form of oral contraceptive pills. But when we offer them to the girls, I never call them as pills, because then, you know, it's a big barrier for mothers to use them. So I call them estrogen progesterone combination pill. I explain the complete physiology, why we are giving them and why it is needed, so that there is more adherence and acceptance of the medicine. So why we are giving it? We are giving it to quieten the ovary and prevent the development, you know, the prevent the functional ovarian hyperandrogenism. And that's how basically, and it also acts by increasing SHBG. So the ovaries will produce less androstenedione ion, and SHBG would decrease the free testosterone levels. So overall effect will come, and cycles will become regular, and basically all the Ferriman Galloway score decreases by 30%, acne get corrected by 50 to 100%. So the role is correction of oligomenorrhea, correction of hyperandrogenism, and also, you know, preventing the development of a true PCOS in at-risk PCOS girls. The medicine, you know, we generally most pills have ethinyl estradiol, and for bone mass, we need at least 30 micrograms. So in adults, we are more used to, because it has less side effects, we more used to pills with 20 micrograms of ethinyl estradiol. To the PCOS guidelines of FOXI recommend never to use less than 20 micrograms in adolescent girls, because then it decreases the bone accuracy. So minimum dose 30 micrograms. So choose your pill correctly. But if you are having breakthrough bleeding with 30 microgram dose, you can go up to 50 micrograms, but never to 20. Adverse effect, we all know. And initiation with high dose can be done, especially in girls who have menorrhagia. So that, you know, you have correct the menorrhagia first and then, you know, taper it down to a lower dose for long term. Progesterone, basically, it is generally for LH inhibition, and it is mostly for endometrial regulation and prevention of development of irregular periods, because giving estrogen alone could lead to a lot of irregular periods, but it has its own adverse effects. And so how to initiate all these things? So generally it is recommended that if you have a girl with oligomenorrhea, amenorrhea, give them a progesterone withdrawal and then start with the pills. But if you have a girl with menorrhagia, straight away start with the pills to correct the bleeding as soon as possible. For hyperandrogenism, a very severe hyperandrogenism, there might be a case of giving them a continuous therapy or a 3-monthly cycle so that they have infrequent pill-free periods and the hyperandrogenism is corrected. So when we look at the effect of treatments, basically on the pills, usually it takes about a couple of months for the periods to become regular. But for the hirsutism, it takes, because the cell hairs have a cycle, so it takes a minimum of 6 to 12 months for the effect of hirsutism to come. Basically, duration of therapy should basically mean that, you know, you have to take it till gynecological maturity, which is at least 5 years post-menarche. And the goal of therapy is that whenever, you know, you have achieved the proper weight loss, which is basically 10%, you can, you know, stop and see whether, you know, the effect of obesity, the hypothalamic pituitary axis has matured, and whether you really need to give them the pill. And there is no role of doing ultrasound to see whether, because this is not correcting the disorder, it is just controlling the disorder. There is no role of doing androgens again and again while on the pill. So how do we follow up? We generally, you know, follow up with blood pressure, BMI levels, and looking for metabolic parameters and the complications from thereafter. So what are the indications of metformin? So generally metformin is needed in almost all cases of PCOS, except perhaps for lean individuals without any clinical features of metabolic syndrome. And metformin, you know, accentuates the effect of estrogen and progesterone pills and has a better, you know, you have a better result in both the hyperandrogenic effects and metabolic syndrome effects. So usually start with a dose of 15,500 and you can go up till 2000. It improves ovulation, it decreases the testosterone as an alone, but definitely use it as a combination therapy along with estrogen and progesterone to have the best effects. Now, how does estrogen and progesterone act? They basically decrease the testosterone by quietening the ovaries and less production of testosterone from the ovaries. They also basically increase the SHBG levels, so free testosterone levels are less. And other methods of control of this thing could be, you know, using epilation, waxing, photo, electrolysis, oflornithine basically is a cutaneous topical arrangement that prevents the cell, you know, it's a cell cycle inhibitor, and it is a topical medication that can be used meanwhile the estrogen and progesterone are having an effect. So these are some additional things that you can use for symptomatic treatment of hirsutism in young girls till the effect of both estrogen, progesterone and metformin comes into play. So PCOS, management of PCOS, just to summarize the management, first would be look at the diagnostic category. So if this girl is your physiological PCOS, then basically within the first 2 years, then there is no need for any treatment. Just follow up the girl and basically enhance the lifestyle management and those things. But unless she has menorrhagia or a very severe hirsutism, no need for treatment in the first 2 years of menarche. But if someone is a definite PCOS, especially who has moderate hirsutism and menorrhagia, then along with lifestyle and correction of metabolic parameters, addition of estrogen and progesterone is a must, both for the current goals of correction of hyperandrogenism and also for prevention of a permanent development of PCOS in adulthood. So the second prevention of the second hit, definitely if there is clinical response, this treatment has to be continued till maturity. But if there is no clinical response, you can add, and especially if you have a severe form of hirsutism, you can at the beginning start with a progesterone pill, which is anti-androgenic, or add an additional anti-androgen. If there is no response, then definitely there is a case of identifying other causes of hyperandrogenism, especially functional adrenal hyperandrogenism. Messages of adolescent PCOS, strict criteria have to be followed to prevent clubbing up with the physiological and immature patients as PCOS. So take a score of at least 15 and a testosterone level of more than 55 before we can say this is hyperandrogenism. Exclude other causes of hyperandrogenism, and especially for virilization, immediate evaluation is needed to rule out adrenal tumors or ovarian tumors. PCOM is not a part of diagnostic criteria of PCOS, and just don't label all girls with polycystic ovarian morphology as PCOS, because any cause of hyperandrogenism would lead to that morphological appearance of PCO. And estrogen, progesterone and antiandrogens is a cornerstone, has to be taken long term till maturity, at least 5 years post-menarche. Thank you.
Dr. Vikas is asking a question regarding, do you agree with PCOD being used loosely in day-to-day practice, as labeling adolescent girl with PCOS will bring lot of psychological trauma? Your expert comments. I think this is a very important
issue. Yeah, this is a very good question. Basically, the North American Society of Pediatric and Adolescent Gynecology does not recommend any adolescent girl with a polycystic ovarian syndrome like clinical features to be labeled as PCOS, because a subset of these girls are still treatable. So PCOS as adulthood is a disease that cannot be cured and it can only be controlled. But in adolescent girls, it is still treatable, preventable disorders because of the newer concept of the second hit hypothesis. And that's why we don't label them and we just keep them at risk, do everything possible. So give them advice on a better lifestyle, treat their hyperandrogenism so that, you know, they come out of it. And it's a very good question, because labeling them basically has a very long-term effect, not only on their psychological health, but also on their sexuality and fertility.
Dr. Ankita from Indore is asking regarding a girl coming from PCOS with irregular cycle and insulin resistant. With regards to treatment, will you consider OCP or metformin?
It depends on what are the if the girl has irregular periods and insulin resistance, definitely you have to combine both the OCPs and metformin. It's not the either, and especially if she has associated hyperandrogenic clinical manifestations like acne or hirsutism, the metformin is not a very great drug to, you know, correct them. And therefore, combination of both. And definitely metformin, we've now come to see that, you know, it has a synergistic effect with the OCPs to have a better result. So both alone are not the better option.
I think a very valid point which you mentioned, that when you add metformin, you may reduce the adverse effects of the OCPs, which are the atherogenic effects. So that is a positive thing. Yeah. So I think metformin is definitely required. The key question is, if you have PCOS, we'll label only if there is hyperandrogenism. So usually you will need a medicine there. I think last couple of questions from Dr. Naresh is regarding if there is, if there is clitoral hypertrophy, do you think you will think of CAH in that setting?
Yes, definitely. If there is, you know, any virilizing features, very rarely you would find that in PCOS. So all those things should be ruled out, especially adrenal carcinoma. If it is a rapid onset or if it is a long term, definitely CAH.
Dr. Parvati from Bangalore is asking if you started E plus P treatment with metformin and there is menorrhagia. I think this question you very well answered.
So basically, generally menorrhagia does not happen on E plus P. Generally what they develop is what we call as breakthrough bleeding. And usually you need to go into the clinical details with the girl, sit down and ask what actually happened. Sometimes it is non-adherence to the medicine, that is skipping pills. Or sometimes the dose of the estrogen and progesterone pill is not enough for that girl. So we generally recommend beginning with a 30 microgram dose. But if she is having breakthrough bleeding, we step up and increase. Usually mid-cycle menorrhagia, generally we would have to, for at least one cycle, switch over to progesterone, control the bleeding, and then begin with a higher pill.
I think final question from Dr. Mudita. Regarding if the child has lost weight, do you still need to wait for 5 years gynecological maturity, or you can taper the EPP earlier?
Yes. If you have achieved the, you know, the desired weight loss, one would generally recommend, after the goals of cutaneous treatment have been achieved, you stop and see. And many girls, as I said, that this is not basically a disease where you can give a confirmatory diagnosis that this is a definite PCOS. We call them at-risk PCOS. A subgroup of them are actually just girls with immature hypothalamic pituitary axis that are behaving like PCOS, and they generally grow out of it. So if you have had, you know, your acne has been treated, the hirsutism is corrected, and the weight loss is achieved, you always stop and see. A true PCOS generally will return back to the previous symptoms, and the confounding will, you know, grow out of it.